Years ago, there was a cadet at the United States Air Force Academy, and outside of his dorm room, he had a little whiteboard, and on that whiteboard, he wrote Galatians 2:20, I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live. And there were some on his floor in his dorm that did not like that, so they went to his authorities. Superiors, and he was told that he had to take that off. And the reason he was told he had to take it off is that it elevated one religion above another. And it poured fundamentalist Christian gasoline on an already out of control conflagration of fundamentalist Christian tyranny. That's a mouthful, isn't it? Those same authorities who made him take Galatians 2:20 off of his door then later allowed on campus of the United States Air Force Academy, they allowed on campus an Ask an Atheist Day. A first grader in North Carolina wrote a poem. And in that poem, she was honoring her grandfathers who had served in Vietnam. And in that poem, she used the word God. Her teacher said, you cannot read that poem unless you take out the word God. A Sonoma State student was told to remove her cross necklace because it might offend other students. An Army email labeled pro-family Christian ministries as a domestic hate group. Okay, pro-family Christian ministries, they labeled it as a hate group, putting it on the same level as the KKK and neo-Nazis. Two middle school sisters took their Bibles to school one day, and the teacher found the Bibles. She took the Bibles from the students, called their mother, and threatened to call Child Protective Services. When the mother came, she looked at the sisters and the mom, took the Bibles, threw them in the trash, and said, that is garbage. Such is the status of what is happening in our nation, in our country. Persecution and the intolerance of Christians in the United States that is rising and rising quickly. Over the past 5 weeks, we have discussed contemporary issues that are at center stage in our nation. Right? The fact that there is absolute truth, the understanding of what transgender is, of homosexuality, of abortion, of our role within the political plan. Issues that go against God's word, that go against His plan for who we are and how we were created to be, how we are to live. And these are issues that will create or increase persecution against followers of Christ. Because as long as we continue to live in opposition to them, as long as we continue to stand up for what we know to be right and true, as long as we continue to be light and salt in this world, we can expect to face opposition, to face persecution. And so today, in the next 4 weeks, we are going to take a look at what the Bible actually says about persecution. Now, let me clarify something. I am not entirely sure the form of persecution that will ultimately come our way. Is it just don't wear that cross necklace? Or will it proceed to something worse? It probably will proceed to something worse, whether it be in our lifetime, our children's lifetime, or our grandchildren's lifetime. And so I'm not suggesting that taking off a cross necklace is equivalent to those around our world, to those even within our country, I suppose, who have died because of their faith. I am not equating the level of severity to that of Pastor Saeed, who was in an Iranian prison for 3 years. Okay, so don't misunderstand me in that. My point simply is that we should be aware that we need to be informed that persecution in some form or some fashion is coming. It is on the horizon. And as long as we understand issues like we've been talking about, and as long as we stand in opposition to them, we should expect persecution. We're going to look at 5 counterintuitive biblical principles for persecution. Now, if you're like me, I had to think about what counterintuitive meant. Okay, you're not like me. Just checking to make sure this thing's on. Right, so counterintuitive means to go against what we naturally or normally think. How we naturally or normally feel. That if we think A, B, C, D should be the pattern, counterintuitive means D, C, B, A. Right, that it goes against the grain, if you will. So we're going to look at things in a new way. Probably seeing things differently than we have understood or seen them before. We have certain preconceived understandings about persecution, do we not? About how we think it should go, about how we should respond to it, about when and to whom should we persecute. And what we're going to find out is that the Bible speaks differently about it than we probably have been raised to understand and probably the church has taught about before. So our first principle for persecution then, from the Bible, is that persecution is normal, not strange. Normal, not strange. Now that's counterintuitive because don't we think of it as abnormal? Right? Don't we think that if we're a good Christian, we shouldn't be persecuted? Don't we look at those who are persecuted and we say, oh God, why are you allowing that to happen? They're so faithful to you. And yet what we're going to see is it's exactly because they're so faithful that they're being persecuted. Turn with me to the book of 1 Peter, or open your Bible app to 1 Peter. Chapter 4, we're going to read verses 12 through 19. Verse 12 will be our focus. We're going to read the whole little set here so we get an idea of all that's going on. 1 Peter 4, beginning verse 12. Peter's writing, "Dear friends, Do not be surprised at the painful trial you are suffering as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice that you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when His glory is revealed. If you are insulted because of the name of Christ, you're blessed. For the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. If you suffer, it should not be as a murderer or thief or any other kind of criminal or even as a meddler. However, if you suffer as a Christian, don't be ashamed, but praise God that you bear that name. For it is time for judgment to begin with the family of God. And if it begins with us, what will the outcome be for those who do not obey the gospel of God? And if it is hard for the righteous to be saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? So then, those who suffer according to God's will should commit themselves to their faithful Creator and continue to do good. So right there, verse 12, Paul says, yes, you're suffering a trial. Why are you surprised by that? Don't be shocked. Don't think of it as being strange. Here he is telling believers who lived in Galatia and southern Asia, what's now Turkey, who are suffering or going through persecutions, and he says, don't let this surprise you. Don't be shocked by this. In other words, what he's saying to believers in Christ is, this is part of the deal. He's saying, this is the normal outcome of your faith in Jesus. This is what you should expect when you said, signed on the dotted line, I commit my life to Christ as my Lord and Savior. This is what comes with it. This is normal. The believers Peter's addressing, they're facing something, right? Some trial. He calls it a painful trial. Some have speculated that what he's referring to is when all the believers were kicked out of Rome by Emperor Claudius. That they were persecuted there and forced to leave their homeland, so they're dealing with all this trial, all this suffering, all this persecution because of their faith. And Peter says, it's normal. It's not strange. Shouldn't be surprising. It's normal. It is part of your faith, he says. It comes with the territory of being a follower of Christ. Now, that whole concept, those verses that Peter wrote, they fly in the face of what we normally hear from the church, of what maybe you were taught, of what maybe you believed, and maybe even still believe. That when we come to Jesus, we have this holy moment that all of a sudden now God owes us nothing but good from here on out, right? We've heard that before how many times? The person who is faithful and still dealing with something, why God? Why are you doing this? Why are you allowing this? As if suffering shouldn't be a part of who we are in Christ. And here Peter says, it is. It should be, and it will be. So all those prosperity gospel people, all those God makes us, or when we come to God, we don't have any problems, they're flat wrong. Bible never teaches that. And here Peter comes right out and addresses it specifically and says it's actually the opposite. When you come to Christ, life's not going to be perfect. When you come to Christ, there's going to be persecution. It's normal. Don't be surprised by it. Now, why does Peter say this? Well, for that, we need to turn to John chapter 15. You can turn there if you want, or you can just listen. John chapter 15, read verses 18 through 25. He says, if the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first. If you belonged to the world, it would have loved you as its own. As it is, you don't belong to the world, but I've chosen you out of the world, and that's why the world hates you. Remember the words I spoke to you. No servant is greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they'll persecute you also. If they obeyed my teaching, they'll obey yours. They will treat you this way because of my name, for they don't know the one who sent me. If I had not come and spoken to them, they would not be guilty of sin. Now, however, they have no excuse for their sin. He who hates me hates my Father as well. If I had not done among them what no one else did, they would not be guilty of sin. But now they have seen these miracles, and yet they have hated both me and my Father. But this is to fulfill what is written in their law. They hated me without reason." Jesus is speaking those words, right? And Peter spent 3+ years with Jesus. He heard what Jesus said. He saw what Jesus saw. He witnessed how people responded to Jesus. And so he is being directly spoken to in these words by Jesus. Jesus and the 12 are in the upper room. John 15 is right in the middle of what's known as the upper room discourse from John 13 to John 17. Those words that Jesus said, taught, or prayed just hours before he was betrayed, after he had instituted the Lord's Supper, had the Last Supper with the disciples, and before he was betrayed by Judas. So why is it that Peter says that persecution is normal for the follower of Christ? Because he was there in the upper room when Jesus said it would be. Right? The words that Jesus spoke there in John 15, he tells to Peter and all the apostles that the world would hate them and by extension will hate us. Because they followed Jesus, because we followed Jesus, Jesus has said the world will hate us. Now, I don't know about you, but to me, hate is a very strong word. I don't like to use it. I don't like it when the boys use it. Right? When they say they hate something, I say, no, you strongly dislike something. Right? Because that word hate is a very passion-filled word, a very ugly word, but yet it's the word that Jesus uses here, and the Greek word that he uses means malicious feelings toward another person. Malicious feelings toward another person. So Jesus is saying the world will have malicious feelings toward you. They will hate you. That is expected and is to be normal. Jesus stated that the world would have malicious feelings toward the disciples and toward us because they had malicious feelings toward him. They hated Jesus. Now, if you scan John 13 through 17, you'll notice there's an interesting order to Jesus' words. Because at the end of John 13, after he's washed the disciples' feet, he's teaching them what he's done, and he said, "I've loved you, now you go and love other people. And when you love other people the way I have loved you," he said, "they will know that you're my disciple." And then he says, "Oh yeah, and by the way, when you're my disciple, they're not going to like you." Now, Jesus was no dummy, right? Notice the order. Love people, they'll know your mind, then they'll hate you. If he had said, "Oh yeah, by the way, they're going to hate you, be my disciple and love them," we'd have said, "I don't think so." Jesus knows that our aversion to pain and conflict and persecution and our desire to have people like us. And so he says, no, you love first. They'll recognize who you are. That you identify with me. And because of that, then they're not going to like you. They're going to hate you because they've hated me. You see, there's no doubt in what Jesus says here. Yes, the first word is if, but that's not really what it means. What he's talking about is since the world hates you. Or if the world hates you, comma, which it does, there's certainty there. The world does and will hate those who follow Jesus because they did, do, and will hate him. Now, who is it that Jesus says will hate us? So it's the world, right? Okay? The Greek word for world is cosmos. Not cosmos, but cosmos. Okay? Meaning the ungodly system of our world, the ungodly system of the earth that permeates everything. What Jesus is saying basically is that the world's beliefs and values are in conflict with your beliefs and values. The world's conflicts and values clash with what you as a follower of Christ proclaim to believe and understand. Yet they are contrary to God and to His Word and to His people. We see it that much clearly now after having gone through these last 5 weeks, right? Understanding the world's view on transgender and homosexuality and abortion and all these things, we see that our understanding of those things differs greatly. They clash. There's conflict there. And because of that, the world is going to hate us. God says that marriage is between one man and one woman. The world has said it can be two men or two women. God says that we were created a specific gender to accomplish a specific purpose in life. And the world says, you don't like what gender you are? Change it. Make yourself happy. We are in conflict with the world. And because they hated Jesus, they're going to hate us. Now, why does the world hate us? John 15, in these verses that we read, gives us three reasons why the world hates us. One is, we're different. Have you ever looked at someone and then whispered to your friend or spouse and said, "Boy, that dude's a little different"? And if you haven't ever said that, you're the one they were talking about. Okay? In small groups, there's something called EGRs, extra grace required people. Right? Those people that require extra grace to get you through the group time. Yeah, if you can't think of anybody, that's you and your group, okay? Count yourself happy that you have a title for your group, all right? But that's you. In verse 19, Jesus said, "We aren't like the world because He chose us out of the world. And because He chose us out of the world, we are different from the world," and they don't like that. In 1 John, the Apostle John writes, "Little children," referring to the church, he said, "Little children, you're from God." They, being those outside the church, he said, they're from the world. So they speak from the world, and the world listens to them. But we are from God. So we're different from the world. Think about your life as a Christ follower. It should be different from the world, right? You do different things than the world. Or you should. You say different words than the world. Or you should. The world is not in a building like this doing what we're doing today, this morning. Because we go different places. Our focus is different. Our belief system is different. The way we conduct ourselves on a daily basis should be different. And because it's different, they don't like us. They hate us. Because they didn't like Jesus and because they hated Him. Author and professor D.A. Carson wrote, "Raw secularism, greedy materialism, immoral special interest groups seeking privilege or alternative lifestyles, which are biblically indefensible, all with one accord resent the Christian who stands up and lovingly insists, 'Thus says the Lord.'" So we're different. That's why they hate us. Secondly, they hate us because we bear Christ's name. John 15, verses 20 and 21 refer to this. And in verse 20, Jesus quotes Himself. I think it's in John 13, He referred to, "No servant is greater than his master." And so here He repeats that, and He does that to show them that they, the disciples, we, His servants, will not escape the same kind of treatment that they gave to Him. Okay, that as a servant, you shouldn't expect to be treated better than the master. And so He's using that to show, look, this is what they're going to do to me. This is how they respond to me. They hate me. You're my follower. You're my servant. You shouldn't expect them to be treated better. That's not going to happen because the servant is not greater than his master. And so all this comes about because we claim Christ as our master. Right? When we profess our faith in Him, we're proclaiming, You are Lord of my life. I'm going to live for You. I'm going to identify as Your follower. And in doing that, then, we're essentially saying, so I can't expect to be treated better than my Master was. Because of that, they'll hate us. Because they hated Him. Now, we see this in Acts, especially the early chapters of Acts, right? Peter and John were taken before the Sanhedrin multiple times. And on one of those occasions, they were flogged, right, which was basically beaten within an inch of their life. And instead of complaining, instead of getting mad at God, and instead of stopping what they were doing, they left the Sanhedrin and said something to this effect, or we're told that this is what their thought was, that they praised God because they had been found worthy of His name. They were excited and they rejoiced and celebrated that they had suffered because people saw them as belonging to Jesus. So to them, what they suffered through that flogging was normal. It was expected. It was not surprising or strange. It's what Jesus had told them would happen. And it's the same thing that we should expect, not be surprised at, not think of as strange, because Jesus told us that it would happen. So the world hates us because we identify with Christ. And we identify with Christ because we have professed faith in Him, making Him our Master. Thirdly, then, we expose their sin. Verses 22 and 24 refer to this. When Jesus came, He made people aware of their sin. Now, that's not to say that they were sinless before He came. But they had a different understanding of how to correct their sin, right? That's the Pharisees' whole deal, right? Do enough good things, do the right things, don't do the bad things, and you'll save yourself. You'll conquer this thing of sin, and you'll be okay. And Jesus came and He said, no, that's totally wrong. That's not how this works. You can't do it yourself. That's why the law was there, to show you, you need someone to save you. Right? So He came and He exposed their sin to them. He fulfilled the law by showing them that the law couldn't accomplish what they hoped or thought it could. And so He has chosen to do the same thing through us as church. Right? That's part of being salt and light. It's not to rub someone's nose in their sin, but it's to help them to see their need for a Savior and that there's a better way. And so when we stand for biblical truth, we're exposing sin. When we proclaim that homosexuality is a sin, we're exposing sin. When we declare that abortion is the killing of a human life, we're exposing sin. And when we expose sin, when we tell the world they're wrong, they don't like it. How many of you like to be told you're wrong? I don't. And so they don't like it when we do that. And they hate us for it. So, as we close here, a couple of takeaways for us that as we begin to understand that persecution is normal and not strange, what do we need to take away from this? Well, first of all, we need to take away that we have to have a committed relationship with Christ. To withstand the persecution and the suffering and the trials, whatever they may be, that are coming our way, we must have a strong, solid, mature faith in Christ. We have to be disciples of Jesus, not just Christians. You know why I say that? Because the word Christian was a derogatory term to the early church. Did you know that? They didn't like it. They didn't come up with it. Those that hated them called them that. They called themselves disciples. Jesus referred to them as disciples. We must be disciples. It becomes too easy just to call ourselves Christian. Right? Because that word Christian has been stretched and pulled and torn and made to cover so many things that it's almost lost its power. So we need to be more than just a Christian. We need to be a disciple of Christ. That means we can't just come here on a Sunday morning. It means we can't just have our name on the membership roll and check off the list and say, hey, I've done my thing for this week, and then go and live our life however we want to. That type of person will not withstand persecution. They just won't. Because they don't have the foundation upon which to stand. Jesus told the story of the two men that built the houses, right? One built his house on the sand. The wind, the rain, the storms came, and that house went crashing down. The other guy built it on rock. The wind, the rain, the storms came, and the house stood. And the difference of the two houses was the foundation. If you're building your house on the foundation of yourself, you will not stand. If you're building it on the foundation of Christ, giving your all to Him, living for Him each and every day, growing in your faith every day, seeking opportunities to share that with others through service, acts of kindness, words. And you're building on the right foundation. And while it won't be pretty or any easier, you will be able to stand. The second takeaway then is, don't be surprised when you hear someone being persecuted or you experience it yourself. Understand, from this point forward, persecution is a normal part of my life as a follower of Jesus. Now, hopefully over the next 4 weeks, we're going to look at some other principles that might make this a little bit more palatable, right? Because that doesn't sound very nice, does it? To think of, I'm being persecuted. Yay me, it's a normal part of life, right? That's not something we're going to get up and do a cheer about. But just like anything in life, once it becomes normal, it does become more acceptable, and we can embrace it better. Remember, Mary Lou and Judy, they have the new normal group. Remember, our transition from our life before Christ to life in Christ, that's a new normal. Right? We're not the old person anymore. We're a new creation, Paul tells us. And in part, or part of that new creation, and part of that new normal is persecution. So when we hear about it, when we read about it, when we experience it ourselves, don't be surprised. It is a normal part of our lives. Should we pray for those who are persecuted? Yes, definitely. No question about it. Do we hurt for those who are hurting? Absolutely. We're to be compassionate, sympathetic, empathetic people. So we should pray for them. But should we get shocked or surprised or fly off the handle or go around half-cocked saying, I can't believe God did this and I can't believe that? No. This is normal. It's part of life as a follower of Jesus. Don't be surprised. Because the world hates you. And the world hates you, and the world hates me, because it hated Him. And who are we to think that we should be any different than Him? Let's pray. Father God, this is probably different than what we've thought before. But that's okay, because sometimes we need to wrestle with things. Sometimes we need to be a little uncomfortable. And so, Lord, I pray that you would help us to embrace and understand better this idea of persecution being normal. And Lord, that we would use it as a springboard to deepen our faith, to mature in you, to grow in you, to build on that solid foundation of Christ alone. So that we can stand. We can't do that on our own. And so help us to open our heart and lives to allow you to have total control and to be that Lord and that Master. So that we can be strong in the face of suffering and trials. In Christ's name we pray.
Let's stand together as we sing those in the song.
Thank you. no spinning room.
Oh, did you? Okay.
Oh.
I they asked me, like when they came in contact, they asked me how that worked. Interim, not having interim part-time youth director. The congregation didn't know the congregation. And then when I became, they made me full-time. That went to the congregation. But if you remember, which you may or may not, the same day they voted on hiring me full-time and installing
right after school, and I can't grab it then, you know?